I'm gonna tell you about one of my super secret strategies, because you need super secret strategies when you can't think of something smart to do. And here's the strategy. Can't do something smart? Then do something stupid. We'll try it on this problem right here. We're looking for the last digit of 2013 to the 2012. I got nothing smart, so what's the stupid thing to do? Stupid thing to do is just multiply it all out. It's not just stupid, it's completely crazy. But got nothing else. Well, we'll get started just by multiplying out 2013 squared. Multiply that by itself. Let's see, I'm up by 3 times the 2013, you get 6,039. And the 1 here, the 10, we're going to multiply this 2013 by the 10 from the 1 there. In the 10's place, and we'll get 20130, and the 0 is not going to give us anything interesting. Then we're going to multiply by 2,000 for the 2 out here in the 1,000's place, and well, we've got our 3 trailing zeros there, and then we've got 4026. Then we add that all up, and we get the 9, and then actually, we don't care about any of this stuff out here. All we care about is the last digit. And check this out. If all we care about is the last digit, we get the last digit just from multiplying the last digits of the two numbers that we started with. We don't even care about the rest of the numbers. The 3 times the 3 is going to give us the last digit here is going to give us the 9. All this other stuff is just going to affect the tens, the hundreds, the thousands, and all those other digits that we don't care about. Whenever you multiply two numbers to get the last digit of the product, all you care about is the product of the last digits of the original numbers. All these other numbers are just going to affect higher places in the number, the tens, the hundreds, all that other stuff we just don't care about. So all we need to look at are the last digits of the numbers we're multiplying. So when we're looking for the last digit of 2013 to the 2012, all we're really looking for is the last digit of 3 to the 2012. In other words, when you start off looking at a problem like this, you're really looking at a problem like this. And now, I still don't know what to do. 3 to the 2012, I mean, that's not as bad as multiplying out 2013 to the 2012, but that's still gonna take forever. I got nothing better, so do something stupid. Let's start pounding out some powers of 3. But all we care about is the last digit, so we're just gonna look at the last digits of these powers. So we'll start off with, 3 to the first is easy. 3 to the first, that's just 3. Then 3 squared, we get to 3 squared by multiplying a 3 by 3. That's gonna end in 9. In fact, it's even going to be 9. 3 cubed, well, we'll get to 3 cubed by multiplying the 3 squared by 3. Multiply 9 by 3, you get something that ends in, that's right, 7. 3 to the 4th, 3 to the 4th, multiply the 3 cubed by 3. It means you're multiplying something that ends in 7 by 3, you're going to get something that ends in 1. All right, 4 down, 2008 to go. 3 to the 5th, we're going to multiply this 3 to the 4th by 3. Multiply 1 by 3, you get 3. 3 to the 6th, we're going to multiply 3 to the 5th by 3. 3 to the 5th ends in 3. Multiply that by 3, you get something that ends in 9. Now we're going to multiply by another 3. That'll give us 3 to the 7th. Multiply something that ends in 9 by 3, you get something that ends in 7. Just like we did over here. 3 to the 8th. Multiply 3 to the 7th by 3, you get 3 to the 8th. Multiply something that ends in 7 by 3, you get 1. We did the same thing over here that we did here, and we can even see why. Once we have this 3 again, we're going to get to the next row just by multiplying by 3. That's the same thing we did over here. We're going to get to the next row, going from 3 to the 6th to the 3 to the 7th by multiplying by 3, just like we did over here. 3 to the 7th to 3 to the 8th, we're just multiplying by 3, just like we did over here. We're just repeating the same 4 steps. Then this next one, multiply by 3, we get 3 to the 9th, is going to end in 3. And around we go. We found a pattern. And how did we find that pattern? We did something stupid, and something good happened. We see this pattern now. The last digits of the powers of 3, they go in these cycles of 4. 3, 9, 7, 1, 3, 9, 7, 1. So you raise 3 to any multiple of 4, you get a number that ends in 1. 3 to the 2012. 2012 is a multiple of 4, so we know that the last digit of 3 to the 2012 is 1. So that means the last digit of 2013 to the 2012 is 1. So we used our key strategy there, do something stupid. And we discovered another great strategy, which is find a pattern. Now, it wasn't enough just to find a pattern. We had to make sure that the pattern really worked. We figured out why the pattern was true. Now, let's try these two strategies on this problem right here. Here we've got a sequence. It's called the Fibonacci sequence, and here's how it works. We start off with 0, 1. Then each term after that, you get by adding the two terms before it. 0 plus 1 is 1. 1 plus 1 is 2. 1 plus 2 is 3. 2 plus 3 is 5. 3 plus 5 is 8. You get the picture. Now, we want to find out how many of the first 1,000 terms, if we just keep going with this, are multiples of 4. Yeah, I don't see it. I don't see the answer right away, so here we go. Can't do something smart, do something stupid. Let's just keep listing some more terms. I got one multiple of 4 right there. I got another multiple of 4 right there. Let's see if we can find some more. 21 plus 34 is 55. 34 plus 55 is 89. 55 plus 89 is 144. We have a winner. There's another multiple of 4. 89 plus 240 plus 144 gives us 233. I don't want to keep doing this, but check this out. There's one here. Then I skip 5 terms and get to another one. Then I skip 5 terms and get to another one. Is that going to keep happening? It would be nice if that were the pattern, but how do I think about whether or not a number is a multiple of 4? Well, I divide 4 into it, and well, if the remainder is 0, I've got a multiple of 4. If the remainder is anything else, I don't, but let's just look at those remainders. We don't actually care what the numbers are. Let's take a look at what those remainders are. So the first term, when I divide it by 4, the remainder is 0. That's pretty easy, and the next few terms are really easy as well. 2, 3, then 5. When I divide 5 by 4, I get a remainder of 1. Then 8 gives me 0. 13 gives me 1. Hey, wait a second. 21, that'll give me 1. 34 gives me 2. Then 3, then 1. See it repeating? I see a pattern. 0, 1, 1, 2, 3, 1. 0, 1, 1, 2, 3, 1. That next one, sure enough, is 0, and then 1, and then dot, dot, and then so on. What's going on here? Well, if I take a number that's a multiple of 4 and I add a number that's 1 more than a multiple of 4, well, that sum is going to be 1 more than a multiple of 4. So that's why the remainder of the next term is going to be 1. If I take two numbers and both of them leave a remainder of 1 when I divide by 4 and I add those two numbers together, well, those two ones that are left over are going to combine and become a 2. 1 plus 1 is 2. Yeah, I bet you knew that one. 1 plus 2, if I take a number that's 1 more than a multiple of 4 and add a number that's 2 more than a multiple of 4, those leftovers are going to combine. We're going to have a number that's 3 more than a multiple of 4. If I take a number that's 2 more than a multiple of 4 and add it to a number that's 3 more than a multiple of 4, they're going to combine, but I've got a whole 4 there. I can knock out a 4. I've got a number left that's 1 more than a multiple of 4. Then if I take a number that's 3 more than a multiple of 4, add to a number that's 1 more than a multiple of 4, I get a number that's 4 more than a multiple of 4. That means I get another multiple of 4. The remainder is going to be 0. These remainders kind of follow the same relationship as the Fibonacci sequence. 0 and 1 is 1. 1 and 1 is 2, 1 and 2 is 3, 2 and 3 is 5, but that means the remainder when I divide by 4 is going to be 1, 3 and 1 is 0. 1 and 0 is 1. And now we're back to the same starting point. And since we generate each term in this sequence just by combining the two before it, once I repeat two terms, I know the whole thing's going to repeat. I combine the 0 and 1 to get this 1. I combine this 1 and 1 to get that 2. I combine this 1 and 2 to get that 3, and so on. So once I have a 0 1 here, and I see another 0 1 here, I know that everything that's going to happen after this is going to be the same as what happened after this. This whole block is going to repeat over and over and over. These little blocks of 6, we've found a pattern and we've explained why it's there. We know that these terms are going to come in blocks of 6 like this, and in each block of 6, we're going to have one multiple of 4. So now I just have to figure out how many blocks of 6 are in this 1,000. So if I take this 1,000 and I divide 6 into it. See, I'll get a 166, and I'm going to have a remainder of 4. So that gives me, ooh, I got to be careful here. I mean, it gives me 166 blocks of 6 like this, and each one of those blocks has a single multiple of 4. So I might write down 166, but I got to be careful in these pattern problems, and when you're counting things out like this, make sure you're not off by 1. What's this remainder 4 all about? When I divide 6 into 1,000, I get 166. That tells me I've got 166 of these blocks, but I do have 4 terms left over. So I go through 166 of these blocks. That gives me 166 multiples of 4. But then I go four more terms. And in those four more terms will be one more multiple of four. So that gives me a total of 167 multiples of four. All right, so moral of the story here is find a pattern. And a good way to find a pattern when you can't do something smart, do something stupid.